Dear ladies and gentlemen, dear Minister Hendricks, dear colleagues, dear friends, it's a pleasure for me to present to you the basis, axis and dimensions of our report on urbanization. And before I drive you into the presentation, I would like to make three pre-remarks. The first pre-remark is that you might ask the question, why should an advisory council on global change focus on local investments, cities? No? But you will see, and we argue in the report, that the drivers of global urbanization processes around the globe, this might be the most important dynamics of social change globally, which are taking place during the first half of the 21st century. This is the first remark. This is a driver of global social and economic change. The second remark is that we argue in the report, and we will show you the data in a second, that achieving the goals which we defined in Paris, the Paris Agreement, the climate agreement on the one hand side, and then the sustainability goals, the 2030 agenda, also autumn 2015, both sets of goals will not be achieved if we don't get cities right globally. This is the second most important message. So 2030 agenda, implementation of Paris, this is about cities and getting cities right. And the third element which I wanted to mention here is that you will see that all these kind of challenges are related to the dimension of time. It's about urgency. I will drive you into, I would like to create a sense of urgency here. And I will show you the data to make clear that the most important decisions regarding getting cities right to implement the 2030 agenda and the Paris Agreement, this is about from now to 2030. If we don't move into the right directions, we are moving into the wrong directions for a very long period of time, because cities' infrastructure is about path dependency. So urgency is very important. The minister allowed me to put off my jacket. Is this still okay for you? So I will do that. To start working. Okay, so let's move into the presentation. And before I start with the first set of messages here, I would like to emphasize, Mrs. Hendricks, that we are very proud that you as a minister are working very hard to move us towards sustainable cities nationally, but also globally. We have been participating in several conferences again and again around this issue, and you took it on board, and this is very important, because it should be on the G20 agenda. It's still not an important topic there. It should be on the G7 agenda. It's still not there. It should be a debate as important as the global climate debate and the global energy debate, but it is still not there. So our report should help to push this issue towards the international agenda. So why is this so important? Here comes the first slide. We talk about the century of cities. And we are talking about a shift towards a civilization of cities, because as you might know, around 2010, for the first time in human history, more people lived in cities than in rural areas. This was something like a tipping point. But as you know, and as you can see here, during the next decades to come, towards 2050, additionally, 3.5 billion people will move into cities. 3.5 billion people. This is doubling global urbanization within 35 years. This is about speed. And this implies that at the end of the first half of this century, 75 to 80% of people are going to live in cities. No? So this is why we take this dynamic so seriously. Most investments in infrastructure and most investments in energy facilities are related to the dynamics of urbanization and the dynamics of building new cities around the globe. When we characterize what is going on there in the field of global urbanization, we use three terms to do so. Sabine, you already mentioned all of those, but I would like to stress them again. For us, it is about speed. This is about the time dimension. Then it is about scale. So many infrastructures being built in a very limited period of time. And speed plus scale is force and power. For the German-speaking people in the room, in German, I use the word Wucht. The Wucht of urbanization. So this is what we need to think about. And here are some elements which describe this speed and scale and force dynamics. The first one is that the same amount of urban infrastructure will be added to the already existing urban infrastructure during the next 30 years, which has been built during the whole period of human mankind. So imagine, no? Human mankind, let's start with the Neolithic Revolution 10,000 years ago. So we needed 10,000 years to build the urban infrastructure which we have on Earth now. We are doubling it within the next 30 years. Speed, scale, force. The second point, which is very important from a climate perspective, if we would use the building materials which we are used to use, this is cement, beton, aluminium, this would imply that we would already observe an important part, between 70 to 75% of the greenhouse gas budget still available, which is compatible with the 1.5 degrees Celsius target, which we talked about and get decisions upon in Paris. So only building the cities will decide upon global temperature. Only building, this is not about consumption patterns, industrialization, new energy facilities, it's only about building the city. So we need to think hard about something which sounds to be or seems to be very technical, building materials. No? We need new building materials to make compatible the urbanization process with climate protection. A third element here to get a sense about the dynamic which we are confronted with, in China alone, more cement was used from 2008 to 2010 than during the entire last century, the 20th century, in the United States of America, in 3 years only. So this is what we are talking about, speed and scale and surge. At this slide, I want to focus on two things. The first message is that on the left-hand side, you can see the urbanization boom, so additional housing, additional cities are emerging in Asia, on the one hand side, and Africa on the other hand side. In the OECD world, we already do have a high level of urbanization. The urbanization rate is already very stable, around 80%. So it's about Asia and Africa when it comes to new urbanization. This is the first important point to have in mind. I will come back to this point a bit later. On the right hand side, you can see something which is very important when you think about shaping and governing urbanization processes. And what we do have here on the right hand side are local public investments. So if local actors should have the power to shape urbanization processes, decide upon their future, they needed governance power on local levels, obviously. And what you can see here is that Denmark is doing very well. 62% of public investments in Denmark are being linked with local authorities. On the other side of the spectrum, you see Kenya. In Kenya, only 1.2% of national public investments, the overall public investments, are local. This implies that Kenya, local actors in Kenya, cannot shape urbanization processes. And we do have a large group of countries where urbanization is growing very rapidly, but local actors do not have the power to shape the process. We don't believe that national actors alone should manage urbanization. Local actors need power to shape their own destinies. So this is are the two messages of this slide here. The third important perspective on what I'm talking about and what we describe in this report is that urbanization is incredibly diverse and complex, and cities are so different. When we started working, I will come back to this point of diversity. When we started working on it, we have been fascinated because the diversity of urban areas are so incredible. This is also a reservoir of creating solutions, of course. Diversity very often is a driver of innovation. No? It is very complex, but at the end of the day, reducing complexity, we found that there are three basic patterns which we can observe currently and which might prolong into the future. And the bad news here is that we need to think hard because all these three basic patterns of global urbanization are not sustainable. So here are the three basic patterns of urbanization. The first one is that probably 1 to 2 billion people additionally will move into areas, urban areas, which we often call slums. So very bad living conditions in these areas. Today we have 850 million people living in these kind of cities and areas. We will get 1 to 2 billion in addition to that. This is southern India, this is parts of Africa, and we need to think hard about that. The second important pattern is that, and this is now Asia, it's China, it's India, other heavily and strongly growing countries in Asia, around 1.5 billion people will move into cities which we describe as scale, speed, and from scratch cities. So entire cities for 1 million, 2 million, 3 million people, for those of you who have been working and are working in China, you know these kind of investments in cities, entirely from scratch. No? And in China and in India, there are many efforts, which is very good and which is good news, to make them as resource efficient and climate efficient as possible. This is great. Mrs. Hendricks, we have been working together in the China Council for International Cooperation on Environment and Development, and we saw that efforts are really there to make these new cities from scratch green. No? But then we saw it also in the Council, think about it now, personally. Do you remember cities which has been growing so rapidly, built up from scratch, which you perceive as livable cities? Cities which you would like to visit, cities where you would like to live. Now think about the cities which you really like. They are very often related to history, because it needs time to develop a culture within a city. So we do have a challenge here. No? Green might work, but how to bring the necessities of people-centered development into these rapidly growing cities in Asia. We have a third trend here, which is taking place in Asia and in Africa. We are talking about middle classes, new middle classes, upper new middle classes. So from a socioeconomic perspective, I'm a development economist, fine. No, people are getting richer. But where would these people like to live? In suburbs. No? You see the suburbs here on the right-hand side. This is Atlanta. This is very resource intensive. This is really, it's not really climate compatible. We need to think about different patterns of urbanization. So this is what we want to mention here. Very briefly, four basic challenges. And during our panel discussions, we probably will move into these different areas very rapidly to get a sense of what we need to think about. The first one is about infrastructure. No, when you think about cities, it is about infrastructure building. It's the building themselves, it's the mobility system in cities, the mobility system between cities, and it's about the energy systems around or within the city, so infrastructure. We talk about $50 trillion of investments during the next 3 decades only in urban infrastructure building. Two messages here. The first one is, therefore, we need to talk with private investors, because most of this money will come from private investors, obviously. So to take sustainable development in cities on the ground, we need to work with private investors. We need to reach out to private investors. Therefore, our first panel is on that. It's not enough only to talk with political decision makers, because at the end of the day, political decision makers need to define the rules of the game, the standards, but we need to have the private sector on board to move into the same direction. This will be key. The second important point regarding infrastructure is that cities, this is about path dependencies. I already mentioned this. No, you cannot close a city. If you have been building a speed and from scratch city in China for 5 million people, this is there for the next decades to come. This is long-term investments. Therefore, it is about lock-ins. And when we think about climate change, when we think about resource efficiency, we all know that we are under time stress here. So avoiding path dependencies. During the next 2 decades, we are moving into the right or wrong decisions when it comes to cities. The second challenge is then about the poverty dimension, the human dignity dimension. We talk about a people-centered approach of urbanization in our report. It's about human security, societal transformations. And here, very briefly, three important issues. We see in many cities around the world that for the 40 bottom of the pyramid in cities, environments and circumstances are very challenging. From social perspectives, environmentally perspectives, access to infrastructure perspectives. In the World Bank Development Corporation, we do have concepts now how to think about growth patterns and economic policies focusing on the bottom 40%. We call this shared prosperity. We do not have this kind of concepts for cities. How do we build cities emphasizing the 40 bottom percent of the pyramid in cities? This is my first point. My second point is that we saw that in many countries around the world, cities are not strong actors, they are weak actors regarding their administration, very often regarding their citizens. So making local actors strong is something which is very important, because if you do not have actors moving into a certain direction of fighting inequalities locally, this will not work. No, you saw the case of Kenya, 1.2% of local investments at the local, of public investment at the local level, this will not work. In Habitat, this was a huge issue. No? It's a political issue, of course, because it is about division of power. It's not only technical, it's political. Therefore, I'm mentioning it. And the third issue, which is related to the social and poverty and human dignity dimension here, is something which was, for me, actually the most important personal learning process. No? I said I'm a development economist, so I've been working about social development in many countries around the world. And we know that social development and fighting poverty is not only about GDP. No? And it's not only about Gini, so the distribution of wealth. It's also about access to infrastructures. But what I learned in this report here is that there is a very strong connection between the well-being of people and how we build our cities. The environment within the city, the structure of the city, the architecture of the city. So well-being of people and social development is very densely related to the way we build and we think about cities. The third dimension, it's from a German Advisory Council on Global Change, focusing on environmental challenges, very easy to demonstrate. We need to decarbonize our cities, the existing ones. We need to organize circular economies, this is about resource flows. And we need to build, from the beginning, low carbon and then zero carbon oriented cities. If we don't get this right during the next two decades, we move exactly in the wrong direction. So decarbonization of cities and circular economy in cities. Only one observation, when it comes to resources, the databases is incredibly bad. We do not have data how many resources are actually flowing into cities and then out of cities. If you would like to organize circular economies, we need much better data here also. No? So, but this is the third big challenge, the green challenge, and in many detail we discuss this issue in our report. The fourth challenge, and this is already the last before I'm finishing with our normative compass, so our normative orientation, how to think about cities. The fourth challenge is about the structure and the size of cities. So why is this important? So what you can see here on this time x-axis from 1950 to 2030 is, on the one hand side, still also in 2030, more than 50% of the global urban population will live in smaller cities, small implies less than 1 million people. No? And our point here is that let's focus more on smaller and medium-sized cities. We don't do so. In research, there's very little about these cities. We know little about those. If you look into international organizations, most programs which are there are focusing on the larger cities, the mega cities, which has, and there are good reasons for that, no? But we need to focus on medium-sized and smaller cities because 50% anyway of people are still living in these smaller and medium cities. So this is the first message. Don't forget the small and medium-sized cities. The second observation here is that you can see that the larger cities, beyond 1 million, even beyond 5 million, 25% of global population in 2030 will live in cities beyond 5 million. No? So the trend is larger cities, concentration. And we don't believe in this concentration because we observe in many cities, very large cities, mega cities, overall, in developing regions, that we do have governance problems, serious governance problems in these kind of cities. So we opt and argue for something which we call, and which is also called in the science literature about urban development, polycentric structures of development. So combining small and medium-sized cities with large cities to avoid this concentration, which has a series of disadvantages which come with concentration. I've been living for a while in Chile. No? In Chile, you need to live in Santiago de Chile. If you don't are in Santiago de Chile, you do not have any chance to make any career. No? In Thailand, 90% of the urban population living in Bangkok. No? Have you ever been in Bangkok? Traffic, energy systems. So we need it more decentralized, we call in favor of polycentric city structures. In Germany, we do have a good starting point here because Germany is a decentralized, has a decentralized urban landscape. So building on this kind of idea is something which we believe on. And here on the right-hand side, you see a picture which is symbolizing concentration and energy efficiency. So some people believe that we can solve best energy efficiency issues in cities which are very concentrated and compact. No? And there are good reasons for that. But we need to balance this with the disadvantages of concentration in megacities. And we argue therefore for several reasons, which you see here on the left-hand side. I'm not going into the details. We believe in the advantages of polycentric governance structures and polycentric urban development. So my last point, 3 minutes to go. The normative compass of the WBGU when it comes to urbanization. We are describing three dimensions in our normative compass, and I will only focus on one because the other two are easy to understand. Well, the first one is about sustainable natural life support systems, so the local and global dimensions from an ecological perspective, the boundaries. We have to accept the ecosystem boundaries locally and globally. No? And we have indicators for that, and if we build cities, we need to have this in mind. Data is sometimes good, sometimes bad. So this is the first dimension. Well, the second dimension is ensure inclusion. In German, we use the word Teilhabe. So inclusion is not only economic inclusion, it's also social inclusion. It's also cultural and political inclusion. So a comprehensive understanding of the capability of people to be part of the society, here urban societies. So inclusion. And then we do have a third dimension, and this is what my last reflections are about. The third dimension is about the diversity of cities, which I already talked about. So we have been fascinated by all these different panoramas of cities which we saw, trying to understand global urbanization processes. And the basic point which we do have in mind here is that if you look at socioeconomic indicators of cities and ecological indicators for cities, resource consumption, etc., you still do not have the concrete city in front of you, which is then related to human well-being. So if you look at cities with a very similar GDP, the city itself and its relatedness to well-being, these are two different stories. And I will show you only some pictures here. Now look at these panoramas of cities. And the basic message is that in very similar contexts, socioeconomic-wise, you find very different cities which are very different from a well-being perspective of humans. And we urge you to think about how to build cities which create the spaces for well-being. And the term which we use is a German term because we did not find a good English translation. No? In German we call it Eigenart, the Eigenart of cities, the specificities of cities. No? Eigenart is a fantastic word. No? Eigenart implies that you do have a type of something, a city. No? These are all cities. And Eigenart, this is, all these cities are very different. No? And let's have a look on these specificities of cities and link this to the idea of well-being. Eigenart. No? I presented it in New York and we started learning German. It worked. No? So Saskia, please remember Eigenart. No? Eigenart, very good. Thank you very much. Okay, so now I'm coming to the last slide before I hand over to the minister. Sabine already talked about the habitat process and where we stand in the global debate on urbanization. And I agree with what has been said by Sabine already. The habitat process was a good start, but we are still not there, no? In terms of setting urbanization very high on the agenda. It needs to be as important as climate and energy because we will decide the future in cities, no? As I tried to make clear with the data which I presented. So here are some conclusions around that. No? We need a reform of the habitat process. No? Urbanization is not a strong issue in the United Nations system. No? If you do not have a strong place for an issue, it's very difficult in the United Nations setting to push an issue forward. No? So this is the first point. The second point, multilateral development organizations. So the World Bank and the African Development Bank, the Asian Development Bank, they are working on cities, there are urbanization programs, but or they are small, too small, compared with the speed, surge, and scale issue here, or they are very fragmented. as in the German system, right? As in the German development system. So you do have people working on bits and pieces of cities and other departments, but there is no strong systemic perspective on urbanization. And this is a systemic issue because we are building entire new cities during the next two, three decades to come. Therefore, we also suggest to establish an international scientific panel on urbanization and its impacts on the 2030 agenda and the Paris agenda, because we will decide upon these agendas in cities. So, getting urbanization high on international agendas, this is what we are aiming at. And as you saw, talking about sustainable development in an era of urbanization is talking about urban development. And this is why we are sitting together here this afternoon. And I'm very grateful now to introduce to you the Minister for Environment and Buildings and Cities. And as I already said, we are proud that in the German context, Ms. Hendricks is really pushing this issue of sustainable cities nationally and globally forward. Thank you very much for your patience.